Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Please note that Mark Griffin will be joining us remotely and apologies have been received from Stephanie Callaghan. And I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Housing Scotland Bill from the following Scottish Government officials: Katrina McKean, who's the Deputy Director of Better Homes, Craig McGuffey, who is the Scottish Government lawyer, Charlotte McAfee, who is a private rented housing team leader, and Yvette Shepherd, who's the head of Housing Services and Rented Sector Reform Unit. And I welcome witnesses to our meeting. And I'd like to begin by inviting Katrina to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much and good morning everybody. We're really pleased to be here to support the committee's scrutiny of the Housing Bill. This bill, if passed by Parliament, will deliver a package of reforms which will help ensure people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. We look forward to discussions today and throughout Stage 1 with yourselves, other members of Parliament and external stakeholders as we seek to ensure that the measures can best achieve these aims. I understand you've agreed the Social Justice and Social Security Committee will lead on Part 5 on the measures for homelessness prevention and Part 6 insofar as it relates to fuel poverty. Today we'll therefore highlight some of the other key measures in Parts 1 to 4 of the Bill, including rent control, greater rights for tenants to keep pets and for private tenants to make changes to a rented home. There are, of course, other measures in the bill, for example, duties for the first tier tribunal and courts to consider the timing of the enforcement of an eviction, reforming how civil damages for unlawful eviction are calculated, enabling the use of unclaimed tenancy deposit funds, providing a mechanism for joint tenants to end a tenancy where there is no mutual agreement, minor modifications to letting agents' regulation to improve clarity of existing requirements, modernising the delivery of notices in the social rented sector, powers to convert older tenancies into private residential tenancies, and a change to the law on mobile homes to tie pitch fee increases to CPI rather than RPI. Due to time constraints, I won't cover those in detail in this summary. However, we are happy to answer any questions you have thereafter. First, on rent control, the bill introduces new powers for the introduction of a nationally consistent system of longer-term private sector rent controls, which will be designated on a geographically specific basis, supported by a local assessment process to achieve fair and stable rent prices for tenants if the bill passes as introduced. The designation of rent control areas, the format and level of the rent cap that will apply in those areas, and the creation of mitigating measures for certain landlords will be provided for in regulations. This is to ensure measures can be tailored to the prevailing rent conditions in a localised area and respond to changing circumstances. The regulations will be fully transparent with detailed requirements for consultation included, and they will of course be subject to parliamentary scrutiny. The bill, as introduced, restricts the powers of ministers to designate a rent control area so that one can only be designated where, firstly, it is necessary and proportionate for the purpose of protecting the social and economic interests of tenants in that area, and secondly, that it is a necessary and proportionate control of a landlord's use of their property in that area. A rent control area can only be designated for a fixed time period of 5 years. Redesignation beyond the set time period would involve further assessment and consultation, and that would be delivered through further secondary legislation. Furthermore, the bill allows ministers to provide for circumstances where the rent cap does not apply or where rent may increase by more than the rent cap. For example, we recognise that landlords may have had rising costs, including the need to improve and repair properties. In addition to the creation of rent controls, the bill aims to improve the renting experience for tenants. Turning firstly to the tenant's right to keep a pet in their home. Provisions in the bill introduce statutory rights for both social and private residential tenants to make a request to their landlord to keep a pet in their home, and that request must not be unreasonably refused. This means landlords would no longer be able to have a blanket ban on keeping pets. However, landlords will still be able to refuse a request where they have good reason to do so. To support operation of the new rights, the bill defines a pet, sets clear timescales for managing requests, provides powers to set out further information to be included within a request, and also how disputes are managed. In the private rented sector, the Scottish ministers will have powers to set out in regulations circumstances in which it would be reasonable for a landlord to refuse a tenant's request and reasonable conditions which may be placed on a landlord's approval of the request. Turning to personalisation, the bill also introduces a statutory framework for private residential tenants to make certain changes to their home, and these are divided into two categories. Category 1 changes would not require the consent of the landlord. Category 2 changes could be requested and not unreasonably refused where a tenant had lived in the let property for more than 6 months. That said, landlords will be able to refuse where it is reasonable to do so or apply reasonable conditions when approving the request. The types of changes that will fall into each of those categories will be set out in secondary legislation and subject to further consultation. As with the right to request a pet, the bill sets clear timescales for requests and regulates how disputes will be managed. For private rented sector cases, this will be through the first tier tribunal. So in conclusion, the Scottish ministers view the measures in the bill as an important next step in delivering our vision for housing. The measures in the bill, as introduced, are intended to help improve the rented sector for all tenants, but particularly lower income tenants living in the private rented sector. Those tenants are particularly negatively impacted by the current pressures on the housing market and the lack of control and choice that they experience as a result. We're more than happy to take any questions that you might have.
Thanks very much, Katrina, for that overview. So, yes, we'll move into questions. And you've touched on some of the areas that I'm going to lead, and you've touched on some of it, but I'm just going to ask a few questions and maybe get a bit more detail. So it'd be interesting to understand how the bill fits in with the Scottish Government's overall housing strategy and what in the strategy is this legislation aiming to address?
Yeah, I think the key focus of the parts 1 to 4 of the bill in terms of tenant protection, the measures are designed to create the legislative framework that then allows for greater protection for tenants, whether that is about the level of rent and the rate of rent increase with the long-term rent controls, and looking at the strengthening of tenant rights. So that very much links to our wider Housing to 2040 vision published in 2021, with a focus on improving choice, improving affordability, and improving the experience of people, their access to housing. Other elements of the bill, of course, the homelessness prevention duties are very much focused on ensuring that we do all we can to ensure that people have a home and a stable home, and that is protected. But looking across the wider system, looking to strengthen those rights of tenants.
Okay, thanks. So clearly this bill is connected to the New Deal for Tenants rented sector strategy. Is there anything else around that strategy that you could tell us around the progress being made there?
Yes. Yvette, I don't know if you want to come in on this one. I would say that the housing bill is certainly the key vehicle by which we're looking to progress the measures in there. There's a lot of work that's required out with the bill. So, for example, looking at how we collect the data that will underpin rent control. And while connected to the bill, there's a range of work ongoing to look at how we do that with local authorities. Similarly, with the homelessness prevention duties, the groundwork needed to ensure that we're working in partnership with local authorities, but also wider public bodies to bring those elements forwards.
Great, thanks. It's always helpful to understand that the bill sits within a broader piece of work. And I think sometimes we can get a bit too focused on just the bill and not understand all the component parts of what you're actually working on. I think you did touch on this a bit. You mentioned, so this is around getting the right balance between the rights of the tenants and the rights of landlords. And you talked about being aware that landlords face rising costs, but also the need for tenants to have obviously affordable housing, but also a good renting experience. You mentioned pets and personalisation in those areas. But is there anything else that you could tell us around how the bill seeks to achieve that right balance between the rights of the tenants and landlords?
Yes, I think a really important element of this is making sure that rent control is well balanced between achieving our stated aim of stabilising rents, but also balanced with the proportionate use of property. The safeguards that are built into the bill, or the ability to set out those safeguards, I think will be particularly important. And Yvette, you might want to say a bit more about that. But in the course of stage one, and now that we have a published bill to have really detailed conversations with stakeholders around, we've already started to have really helpful conversations with landlord representatives, with tenant representatives about the practical implications of what is set out, how things will work, and able to have those discussions on key elements. We know that greater certainty is really important for landlords and for people considering investing in private housing in Scotland. But we have to balance that with flexibility to local requirements, which is why we have structured rent control in the way that we have, with a local assessment being an essential part of that process. So we're very much still in conversations with stakeholders about whether we've got the balance right now and whether there are any changes that should be considered, and those conversations will be ongoing. Yvette, would there be anything you would add?
I think in terms of the specific powers within the bill that allow us to take account of those sorts of circumstances, and in relation to ministers having the power through secondary legislation to exempt certain types of property based on the circumstances of the landlord and the tenant from the rent control regime, and also another power that allows ministers to set circumstances whereby a rent increase above the level of the cap could be brought forward. So those are the two key measures, but there are, as Katrina alludes to, the kind of local circumstances, the consideration by local authority, and the due process through consultation and parliamentary process is part of that safeguards package for landlords as well.
Okay, thanks for that. So actually, kind of, you both mentioned the kind of the local nuance in a way, and I'd be interested to hear how the differing nature of rented housing in rural and urban areas were considered when the proposals for this legislation were being drafted.
And engagement with stakeholders in that space has been important and will continue to be important as we understand that. Also recognising the interactions with the Affordable Housing Supply Programme and the focus on rural and island communities that we're bringing through our Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. That focus on ensuring that it is about local data being collected, ensuring that the local authority is in the lead on making that assessment of whether a rent control area is required, both the initial screening process but also the subsequent more detailed assessment. Is there anything you would add in specifics?
In relation to the assessment part of the process and the sort of on and the subsequent designation, within the bill as laid out at the moment, local authorities can designate all or part of their area. And that's included to reflect that even within a local authority area, there will be differences in local circumstances and different conditions in relation to rent in different parts of the local authority area. So that measure coming forward in the bill was part of being able to respond to concerns about different sets of circumstances, even within a single local authority area.
Great. OK, thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin. He's got a question. He's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener. Before I ask my question, just draw members' attention to my register of interest, which showed that I was an owner of a private rented property up until July last year in the North Lanarkshire Council area. Can I just ask the Bill team if you're able to provide an overview of the quality impacts of the Bill's provisions, particularly related to the rented housing proposals?
On that and bring colleagues in. One of the key things that we have been aware of throughout the development of the proposals is that those in living in the private rented sector are more likely to be on a lower income and as such have particular considerations that we need to be thinking about. We have a higher proportion of women, a higher proportion of single parent households living in the private rented sector, and we need to take those things into account as we develop these proposals. Are there other more detailed things we would add?
Perhaps just to say that as we've taken forward the development of the measures, we've been working with lots of individual stakeholder groups, and we've brought together a multi-stakeholder private rented sector group to support the development of the measures, and we've tried to make sure that within that stakeholder group that we have been working with, that we've got really broad representation, so bringing in organisations that support, as Katrina alludes to, people on low incomes, those who have difficulty accessing accommodation, just to make sure that as we've gone through the process, we've been trying to take these equalities impacts into consideration as we've gone through that development process.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. We're going to now, that was really get a kind of intention to get a bit of an overview of the bill. We're going to move on to a bit more detailed questions, and I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald on questions around rent.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. Before I ask my questions, I'm just looking for a bit of clarification to the questions that the Convener asked. My understanding is that Scottish Ministers can only designate a rent control area if they're satisfied that it's both, and I quote, necessary and proportionate for the purpose of protecting the social and economic interests of tenants in the area, and is necessary and proportionate control of landlords' use of the property in the area. There's a bit of conflict of interest in there, so how is that going to be assessed about who takes precedence?
Yes, I think the key consideration here, I suppose that you're looking to unpack, is the property rights of landlords, and the key is to have that proportionate impact. So there is a case, if the case for protecting tenants' rights in the area is sufficiently strong, then that impacts the assessment of proportionality for the use of impacting on the landlord's property rights. So you would have to have a clear set of evidence and data to demonstrate that the need for rent control outweighs then or is appropriately balanced with the impact that would have on the landlord. So it will be a finely balanced decision to make, and which is why we're working with local authorities to build that sense of what data can be used, what data can be built up to inform their assessment, and also to inform the advice to Scottish Ministers and the recommendation that goes to Scottish Ministers, and then their subsequent legal consideration of that balance. Craig, I don't know if you would want to say a wee bit more from a legal perspective.
I think that sounds okay. Well, it's a balancing exercise between two sets of competing rights. Obviously, the further the rent control area goes in protecting tenants, i.e. the broader the area, the lower the level of the rent cap, the greater the intrusion into the property rights of landlords. So we need to find a level for the rent cap, the extent of the rent control area, the safeguards in the rent control area that balances out the impact on landlords. And there will be an impact on landlords when it comes to rent control. That's the purpose here, I suppose.
And the only other bit of clarification I'm looking for is when you're asking councils to collect data, and some of my colleagues might ask other questions about data, will condition survey be taken into account in value for money?
We are still building up those proposals, and I think that those are certainly things we would want to take under consideration as to whether they can feature helpfully in that rent control data collection. Okay. And part of what we're looking at is what already exists, what data is held. As committee members will be aware, there's very little data held on individual properties at a kind of census level. That's not the sort of data we have. It is more along the lines of the house condition survey and that sampling approach. The information we have on broad market rental areas that underpin the work of Rent Service Scotland. Again, it's a sample approach rather than a comprehensive list. The question of how much further we can and should go in terms of getting more detailed information is a very live one, and one we're working on at the moment. We recognise how important it is to get that right. So I think we can commit to taking that away as part of our considerations going forward, unless you'd want to add anything about it.
I think the way the bill is framed as it stands at the moment is that there is a list of information that local authorities can require from landlords, that this information is provided, but that list can be amended by Scottish ministers through regulations.
So you already mentioned that we've got rent pressure zones, so why do we need rent control areas?
Yes, a very good question. And where the rent pressure zone legislation provides for the ability of local authorities to bring forwards a recommendation that a rent pressure zone is needed, what this bill does is requires an assessment by all local authorities and provides for a much more robust legislative framework to actually bring those rent control areas about in a way that balances landlord rights and tenant rights and proves a workable framework that can be used for the protection of tenants. I think we learned a lot from the rent pressure zone legislation and the difficulties that local authorities have had with that legislation and bringing it into play where they have felt that it would be helpful. They've faced a number of barriers. So that has been a really informative piece of legislation that has helped us to build this proposal in a way that we're more confident will work in practice and have that, as I say, that requirement on local authorities to conduct the initial screening assessment and to then progress that if the data shows that a rent control area would be proportionate and necessary.
Okay. And my last question is about unclaimed tenancy deposits. The information we've been given suggests it's around £4 million. The scheme, the statutory deposit scheme, came in 2012. Does that £4 million, is it cumulative from 2012 or what's been happening to deposits up until now if it isn't? And secondly, what do you see as being the annualised amount that goes unclaimed on average?
That's not a level of detail that I have, Charlotte. Are you able to?
So in terms of since 2012 is the £4 million mark, it is increasing annually. I don't have that figure to hand, but we can certainly write to the committee and provide that sort of annualised figure for you. But yes, it is accumulating. There are different levels. We have some from the very beginning, which you know have been unclaimed since almost the start, and then we have others that are more recent. And the schemes have been doing a lot of work to try and ensure that deposit schemes are claimed, because obviously the deposits should be reclaimed. But that, you know, obviously there's still a fair number that seem to go unclaimed.
Okay. And just as a follow-up, what is being proposed that these unclaimed deposits, will be used for if it goes back to the Scottish Government ministers?
So the bill does is it sets some limits around what ministers can use the money for. Obviously, this is tenants' money, so the rather than landlords, the money is returned to the landlord, their portion, and it's the proportion that's good to go to the tenant that is unclaimed. So the bill sets out a number of things around advice, information, all focused on benefiting private rented tenants. The bill includes powers to amend that list if there seems to be, you know, once it's operational, there's a need to amend it to allow other uses. It can also be used to facilitate the distribution of those funds as well, a small portion of it.
Okay, thanks very much, Kim.
Thanks. I'm just going to pick up on the rent control areas. I just wanted to get a little bit more detail there. So I'd be interested to understand if you your consideration around putting the duty on ministers to decide whether or not to propose or designate rent control areas informed by the local authorities will actually protect local authorities from the pressure and legal risk. Was that some of the thinking there? And from your kind of designing of this bill, can we be assured that Scottish ministers are prepared and resourced to shoulder that risk when necessary?
Yeah. In terms of that preparing local authorities, I think that's absolutely critical. And indeed, the Minister was at the COSLA Housing Conveners meeting last week with the COSLA spokesperson for community wellbeing. And that was a subject of some discussion, some really helpful discussion. And now that we have a published bill, that really helps us to be able to get into the detail and the specifics. We can talk more clearly and more specifically about how we're proposing rent control to work in practice and getting that initial feedback from local authorities. There's a clear appetite, and we really welcome that, for those discussions to continue in terms of what that looks like. We have set out initial costings in the financial memorandum, and with due regard to the likely financial impact on local authorities, that's something that I think we will build our understanding of that as we go through this process and are able to talk in greater detail with local authorities about what sorts of processes they might need to support and what sort of data they might need to draw on. Also making sure that the provisions we have in the bill give them the right rights and the right powers to ask for the right information and so on. In terms of the way that the bill is constituted, the principle is to have a national system of rent controls, but with local designation. So having that balance again, there's lots of balances across the bill that we're trying to strike, and that again is one of those areas, and making sure that the legislation is robust and has those several layers of consideration that will be given to the evidence and the case. Both the data-driven case and that legal assessment balance of risks. Obviously, legal assessment will be done in different ways by different teams within local authorities versus in Scottish Government, and that additional protection and consideration in the process. Are there other elements we would want to bring up?
Yeah, I think that what we have conceived and what we've been working with local authorities, we have a local authority working group that have been working with Scottish Government officials on particularly the assessment part of the process. And what we're hoping for and what we're working towards is providing a relatively agreed approach with local authorities collectively. That would mean that there is guidance and support available to local authorities to ensure that, as far as is reasonable, there's a consistent approach to the assessment part of the process, which helps local authorities in terms of delivering their duties and also is useful for Scottish ministers in analysing the reports and recommendations that come forward for local authorities and making their decisions as to whether or not rent control areas should be implemented in any particular areas.
Thanks for that. I just wanted to also get a little bit of detail, and you may have mentioned this in the opening, I can't remember, but I just want to get a bit more detail on the difference between the rent control areas and the rent pressure zones. So how are they applied? How are rent controls applied differently in terms of tenancies and in terms of the, you know, what does the legislation allow in terms of a rent increase, and also and I think you did say this, I just want to clarify that rent controls can apply across all local whole local authority, whereas rent pressure zones couldn't do that. So if you can just clarify those pieces, that would be great.
Yes, so that there is, as Yvette was saying, that ability to have the whole local authority designated or part, and that's an important difference. The rent pressure zones provisions under the 2016 Act would allow a rent cap to be applied to rent increases during the course of a tenancy, but do not allow for restrictions to be applied to increases in rents between tenancies. So that's another really important difference in terms of these proposals compared to what's already in place. As I've mentioned, there's no duty on local authorities to carry out regular assessments of rents within their area under RPZ legislation, and they do not provide adequate consideration of rents in the context of the protection of tenants, which is another change in emphasis and something that's guided the development of the current proposals under consideration. So in bringing forward this bill, Scottish ministers do consider there's a need for a system of rent control that will ensure an ongoing and nationally consistent approach to considering conditions in relation to private rented sector rents across Scotland. And that is very much an alternative to the voluntary approach that's provided for under the rent pressure zone provisions. I think the other element that we would flag is that under the proposed measures, in order for a rent control area to be designated, Scottish ministers must be satisfied that restricting the rate of the rent in that area is necessary and proportionate, again, for that purpose of supporting the social and economic interests of tenants in the area. allowing for that balance with the proportionate control of landlords' property use in that area. But that allows for local circumstances, but also rent conditions across Scotland to be taken into account, and ensuring that rent controls are applied only where it's justified and proportionate to do so. So although we're shifting from that voluntary approach to one that's required, it's not that in no way will discount the evidence, and indeed there's a more workable framework that we think we will be able to bring about to ensure that the evidence is at the heart of these considerations, but allowing for that requirement for that assessment to come in.
Okay, thanks, that's really helpful. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs, who's got some more questions in this area.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. You mentioned the principle of this is around stabilising rents, but just wondered what your assessment has been of the impact of the rent controls which we've seen, which were put in for under emergency measures by Parliament, which now see Scotland with some of the highest increases in rent anywhere in the UK, and this bill coming forward potentially turbocharging that for people renting in different communities.
I think the first thing we would want to say is that we are clear this legislation needs to be robust, it needs to be fit for purpose. And the issues stakeholders are raising about rent control and investment are a really important consideration that we are taking very seriously and that will determine the implementation of any legislation. But there will be a continuing listening process throughout stage one and throughout the passage of the bill as we seek to make sure that we're responding to that really important stakeholder feedback. In terms of the Cost of Living Act and the impact that that had on rents, we do know, of course, that those measures were only rent control within a tenancy. And the data that we have seen, the data that we have and have been looking at, shows the increases on advertised rents. So that's new tenancies starting. So those were the tenancies out with the protections provided by the Cost of Living Act. Of course, for those tenancies that were covered by the Act, we know that there will have been a period of time where there was no rent increase and a further period of time where that was capped. We will be looking to gather information on what has happened since the conclusion of that Act at the end of March, and that will be a really important part of our considerations. The strategy that we have here is very much to stabilise rents. It is to balance that with the proportionate use of or the proportionate impact on landlords' property rights. We do also recognise that if we are to provide a well-functioning, effective housing system and a thriving private rented sector, we want a system that works for tenants but that is also a viable investment proposition. So balancing those three areas, considering all those three areas, will be part of the considerations going forwards. Our engagement with investor stakeholders has been really strong throughout, I would say, probably strengthened by the Cost of Living Act, by the immediate nature of that and the need to quickly build those relationships that we have maintained. And so that is very much a part of these considerations. The wider stakeholder engagement with tenant stakeholders, with individual landlords, is every bit as important. So finding the right balance across all those measures will be critical.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I think some of the concerns which have been raised around mid-market rent, for example, within the bill, I think are really important and something we should look towards reforming already as the bill stands. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to the rent control areas, and we've touched upon rent pressure zones, but just wondered specifically what timescale and process for developing these regulations you'd look to take forward, and also in terms of the rent control areas outlined in the bill, what would happen during a gap between the ending of any potential rent control area being designated, and this could be multiple in a council area, I think my understanding from what you've said could take place, and the risk we then would potentially see of landlords increasing rents, especially for new lets, and we've kind of seen that under the emergency regulations with new lets coming forward, where the market has moved, and in Edinburgh we've seen that completely different levels of rent for the same type of flat. And just wondered the unintended consequence of this, and we've seen this globally where rent controls have been used. Yeah. is actually the same property can be sometimes double the rent.
Yeah, and those unintended consequences have been front and centre to the considerations from the outset and learning from other areas. So we have sought to design a framework that best balances all of those interests. As I've said, this process we hope will strengthen that and picking up on some of those points. You mentioned mid-market rent, and we're in contact with the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, very much aware of their representations in this area, also talking with individual social landlords where this is something that they're particularly interested in discussing with us, and that is under active consideration as part of how we look at the measures of the bill and the package, as with the wide range of stakeholder input that we're getting at the moment. So we are committed to continuing to work with them to get to the best position within that. As we've mentioned, there are powers within the bill for ministers to provide exemptions for certain types of property, and so there is that flexibility built into the framework as things stand at the moment. Are there other points on mid-market rent we would want to flag? In terms of developing the regulations for rent control, the stakeholder group that Yvette has mentioned will be a really critical piece of stakeholder engagement there for us to work practically through how some of this will work in practice and develop the regulations accordingly. There will be a process by which we need to develop those regulations, consult on them following the bill being passed, if that's the decision of Parliament, and we do see guidance developed as part of that as a really important part of the process as well. You asked specifically about what would happen at the end of a rent control area designation. I think that is something that we want to particularly look at as part of the development of guidance and advice. We do have existing processes in place around rent adjudication, for example, through the first tier tribunal, and that's something that's strengthened by other provisions in the bill. I think it is absolutely something that we're mindful of. Our learning from the Cost of Living Act will be a part of that process as well, as we've only just seen that act come to an end, but we're keeping a really close eye on what's happening in the bridging measures for the rent adjudication, a modified process that's designed to bridge our way out of that emergency legislation. And certainly it is a key consideration. Is there anything you'd want to add there about it?
I think the system is designed that it will be cyclical. So the bill as it stands contains a date by which the local authorities will provide their first assessment report and recommendation to Scottish ministers. And then there will be the subsequent decision-making around designation. And then those assessments and the date for provision will run on a cyclical basis. So before any rent control area comes to an end, there will be the assessment report and a further recommendation before we reach that date when the rent control area would either be suggested to be continued or would fall. The bill, as it stands, does contain a power for Scottish ministers to make provision for the exit from a rent control area in quite a restricted way, and it's building on the work and the experience through the cost of living will help us to understand how ministers could, if they choose to, exercise that power to set regulations that support the exit from a rent control area.
Okay, thank you for that. I wanted to touch also on data, and you've mentioned some of the work Scottish Government planned to do, but I just wondered what impact that potentially could have on councils, specifically with regard to the requirement for councils to assess rent conditions in their areas. Do councils, and smaller councils in Scotland, I'm thinking of specifically, have the analytical capacity to undertake that and the additional workforce challenges which are raised with us regularly, which that would bring? And also with regards to data collection roles for councils, why that had been proposed instead of considering, for example, that to be at a national level. And there are obviously different data sets which are provided at a national level, but I just thought on the face of the bill why that wasn't included.
Okay, so the collection of robust data particularly in relation to those in-tenancy rent increases, which are going to be a critical part of these assessments. We recognise that it is a complex task, and we absolutely agree that it's a considerable ask of local authorities, which is part of why we're so keen to make sure that we were engaging with them from the outset, including through the local authority working group that we've spoken about. We recognise that we need to have a clear strategy that sees us into the future on this, and that there is likely to be a need for some incremental approach as the legislation beds in and is used, and as we learn from the process that we have in place to begin with, and whether that needs to be adapted, improved, built upon. We are liaising with local authorities to explore the collection of any necessary data to inform the rent control assessment, and that is an ongoing process at the moment. I wouldn't discount the possibility of there being national level data that would support local authority assessments, but we're not yet at a point in the process where we could be definitive about how that would work in practice. I think the balance, again, of the cost of data collection versus the robustness and the reliability of that data will be an ongoing consideration for us in national government, but also for local authorities, even in a circumstance where we might have national data that can be drawn on. I would expect local authorities would want to also have that flexibility to draw on their own local level data. Yeah. I think the provisions in the bill providing the powers to local authorities to ask for specific information for landlords is really important here. And while it is a different process, there is obviously teams of people within local authorities at the moment who support landlord registration, and we want to be clear about how the local authority role in total would work. But we need to speak further with local authorities before we can be definitive there.
And just finally, I wanted to ask, obviously, since the bill was published, the Scottish Government's declared a housing emergency in response to lots of councils, some with the largest rent increases declaring housing emergencies, my own here in Edinburgh being one of those. And just wondered what response you have then had for the bill. The homelessness duties, which you touched upon, for example, as far as I can see, already exist and are being swept together in this bill. And, for example, children, families in temporary accommodation shouldn't be in for more than a week. In Edinburgh, they're in for, some cases, 2 years. So I just wondered what real impact you genuinely think this bill will make, because I'm concerned that this is very much politicians talking about a bill where local authorities don't have any capacity and, in fact, could see capacity lost going forward. So just wondered where the delivery of those outcomes actually can be achieved and things don't actually get worse. With this bill, I think it's something we have to be very mindful of.
Absolutely, and the wider context in which this bill sits is really important. This bill is very much aimed at the longer term. It is aimed at setting out a framework that stabilises rents, that strengthens tenants' rights, that shifts the emphasis towards prevention of homelessness, not just by local authorities but by all partners listed, and indeed setting that environment, that culture of looking to prevention of housing problems and avoiding homelessness, avoiding rents rising to a point where affordability becomes an increasing problem for tenants. So it is very much about setting that future-facing framework. That doesn't mean that we don't need to be doing all we can in the immediate term, working with local authorities, working with local government, and identifying all that Scottish Government can do to tackle the immediate housing pressures, particularly in places like Edinburgh, facing record numbers in temporary accommodation and wider housing pressures, but actually across the whole country, and recognising, as was mentioned earlier, the impact on rural island communities as well. So it's not an either-or, I think, would be our sense as officials. Mm-hmm. This bill is about progressing that future-facing framework whilst still taking the action that's required right now to address immediate pressures.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks for that, Miles. I'm going to bring in Gordon with Pulis. You did cover it. Okay, good. Well, I want to actually ask a little bit more about the landlord's register. and in relation to data collection. I'm interested to know, in the process of the work on this bill, if the Scottish Government considered requiring landlords to provide evidence of meeting the basic safety, environmental and environmental standards. So they already have to go through the process of EPCs, and electrical certificates and gas safety checks and that type of thing. And I'd be interested to know what the implications would be of making this a responsibility of landlords to provide that proactively, but also if you've given any consideration to that being provided publicly so that tenants are aware of the kind of context of the rental housing before they go into it, before they go into an agreement with the landlord.
Yeah. We have considered the role of the landlord register and the legislative framework that underpins landlord registration in going through the course of this bill, but also in considering the government's proposals around heat in buildings. In terms of this bill, it's something that wasn't seen as a central consideration for the development of rent control. I do see the case that you're making for that wider information, and it's certainly something that we can take away. We do have a landlord registration framework and a technical IT system or a set of IT systems that underpin landlord registration that are designed for a particular purpose. And while we are always thoughtful about how that could be flexed to meet other aims that have emerged since the original legislation was put in place, it is not always a straightforward proposition, as I'm sure the committee will be aware of. So the provision of information around the energy efficiency standards, for example, as I say, is definitely something that is being considered, but there isn't a straightforward path to including that within existing data collections. So not something that's off the table, but certainly not something that we felt it was right to actively bring forwards in this bill.
Okay, it's interesting, in the beginning you were saying that part of the bill is about improving the renting experience, and you were talking about pets and personalisation in that specific case, but I could imagine that knowing that you have a landlord that actually proactively provides all those certificates and that makes sure that those requirements are fulfilled would be also a helpful piece in terms of the relationship that you're entering into.
Yeah, and that's certainly something we can take away and give further consideration to. I think the interaction with the heat and buildings proposals and what's being consulted on there is a really important link that we've been very mindful of throughout, and continuing to get that balance right in terms of what information we're asking for from landlords and how well we're balancing the asks with the benefits to tenants. But I do think it's a good point that we'll take away.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, you'll probably be aware that the committee has a petition that we're monitoring, position 1778, around the landlord register in general, and kind of concerns that it doesn't really do what it needs to do. So I think maybe there's something in that space as well. I take that this bill is being drawn around the kind of provision of affordable rent, but I think there's something about the experience that you are paying for in a way that's also quite important.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin with another question.
Thanks, Camilla. We've heard evidence that suggests that the use of the rent adjudication process is relatively low. I'd just like to ask why you think that is.
Something we're very keen to do is raise awareness of tenants' rights, and there's been a number of campaigns in recent years aimed at doing that. I think that will be an important part of making sure that there is greater use made of rent adjudication where appropriate. Charlotte, I don't know if you or Yvette want to come in on
Yeah, happy to. With you're right, the rent adjudication process hasn't been used as we had, as it had been expected to when it, since it came in. As Katrina alluded to, we have done a number of campaigns, and there was improvement in terms of use of the service, but it was obviously sort of postponed in a sense due to the Cost of Living Act, and wasn't able to be used for a while. And one of the key things in looking at how it has been used as a barrier is the risk that a tenant faces if they do challenge the rent, that it could be set higher. Now, we know from looking at the data that that hasn't actually resulted in higher rents on many occasions. I think it's only two. But there was from our Rent Service Scotland colleagues, they get a lot of calls to the service, and they reflected on people asking about that and raising that as a concern, and then not seeing an application then come through following their discussion. So we think that that risk that tenants feel, that actually if they challenge it, they could end up in a worse situation than the one that they already or a worsened rent increase from their perspective is one of the key factors, hence why the bill looks to cap the level of an adjudication at the amount proposed by the landlord.
Oh, OK. That's interesting to know that you're having conversations with Rent Service Scotland, and they're flagging that as an issue, and that being the driver of the change in the bill. Do you have any information on the number of inquiries that are coming in that are then not followed up into to full applications, essentially, as a result of those conversations, and as well as the change to remove the ability to set a higher rent, were there any other measures that you think or were considered to improve access to the adjudication process?
In terms of Rent Service Scotland, I don't know that they keep data on that. I think it's very much, but colleagues, I think, are later and would be able to confirm whether they do or not. In terms of other options, I think the main one's really around awareness raising of rights, and that has been the main focus up until this point, of ensuring that tenants are aware that there's been a number of pieces of research which show that that is an area where we can still make improvement, is around awareness of rights and also about how to exercise those rights. So that's, I think, an ongoing process.
Thank you. Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks. Yeah, and we're going to have Rent Service Scotland, who are actually in the room at the moment, joining us shortly, so we can ask a bit more detail on that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a number of questions around evictions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone in the panel. I want to just firstly go back to the point that Gordon MacDonald raised on tenancy deposits. As you know, at the end of a tenancy, a deposit may be withheld in full or in part by a landlord, depending on a number of factors, usually the condition that the property was left in at the end of the tenancy. How does a tenant, how does that process seem to be fair in terms of the assessment of the condition of a property when a tenant leaves? And when the tenant does leave, are they still legally entitled to pursue the deposit?
So there are processes in place, and Charlotte, I think you're probably best placed to answer that.
So the processes are in place. So we have our three tenancy deposit schemes who manage that process in line with the regulations that have been set. When the tenancy comes to an end, there should be documentation, and the landlord will do a checkout. They will look at the condition of the property to evidence whether there's any damage caused by the tenant, and they will, usually there's an agreement between the landlord and the tenant on what would be reasonable deductions for any damage that's been caused. Where there's a dispute, then each of the three schemes has a free adjudication dispute resolution service that will look at the evidence presented by both the landlord and the tenant and come to a conclusion on the best way in which to proportion up the the deposit that's there. That service has very specific timescales set around through the regulations for its operation, and the schemes sort of support that service through the provision of information to both landlords and tenants on the best way to present the information that they need to make those decisions.
Does any amount of a tenant's deposit that is withheld for those reasons, is that part of this £4 million that Gordon MacDonald referred to, or is that completely removed and deducted and gone forever?
Yeah, so what happens is where there for an unclaimed deposit, the landlord proposes the amount that they want to retain, and it's really where the tenant doesn't communicate. There are statutory timescales in which they need to do so. At which point, if the tenant doesn't respond and the scheme can't get in touch with them, then that part of the money that was to go to the tenant, the proportion that's to be paid to the landlord goes to the landlord, but the proportion that was for the tenant is this unclaimed deposit and sits with the schemes indefinitely. So they have to be protected in client accounts, and that money is then protected until the tenant comes to claim it. But obviously what we found is that many of those deposits don't get reclaimed. We think from looking at the sort of review from tenancy deposit schemes, a lot of the people who don't reclaim tend to be international students, and I think we've been working the schemes have been working to address sort of information around that to help people reclaim. But it's the proportion that is only tenants' money that is in the unclaimed deposits.
Mm-hmm. And there's no provision in this bill to try to address that particular issue, because it could be thousands of people that are due a return on their deposit that just aren't claiming it.
That's right. I think that although there's nothing in this bill, that we do already have powers within regulations to make changes to try and address why tenancy deposits become unclaimed in the first place. One of the reasons is that we have that the schemes only have one set of information. So we are proposing to support the implementation of this part of the bill also with taking forward regulations.
OK, that's brilliant. Thanks for that. Turning to evictions, the bill in front of us, it proposes to require the courts and tribunal to consider whether to delay an eviction, but that discretion is already there, as we understand. Why have we decided to change the bill to do something that can already happen?
It's an additional layer of protection for tenants. It's ensuring that there's a clarity all around that this is something that must be considered. So it's strengthening the protection for tenants by allowing for that to be more front and centre in the ask of the tribunal when they're considering a case. But as you've said, in practice, it's not something that fundamentally changes the powers of the tribunal to consider these things, but placing greater emphasis on it, and it is particularly focused around the recognising that at certain times of year, certain religious festivals or certain wider situations in a household's experience can have relevance, and recognising that more formally in terms of both the legislation and the guidance that we'll provide subsequently. Charlotte, I don't know if you would add anything to that.
I think that covers it. I think the other element here is that some tenants don't necessarily find it easy to engage with the process. So while some may actively look for a delay and bring forward those issues, others may not do so. So this gives those tenants an opportunity to come forward and say, actually, there is circumstances here which would mean that a small delay to the enforcement would be beneficial.
Hmm. Is there any evidence that we gathered about the use of these discretionary delays, or are they very few? I mean, what sort of numbers are you talking about in Scotland?
It's something that was covered in the New Deal for Tenants consultation, and at that point the proposition, if I recall correctly, was around delaying winter evictions in particular, and that was something that we therefore were able to get feedback on and help to shape our proposals. In terms of the cases going through the tribunal, it's more difficult, I think, to sort of gather information on what might have happened if we had had this measure in place, so it's more in terms of the experiences that people have had and that the feedback coming through of how this could be useful, but not framed in terms of winter, but actually framed more generally in terms of allowing for that forefronting of wider circumstances year-round, recognising that different times of year can present different challenges.
OK. On the issue of grounds for eviction, I don't think the Bill's proposing any changes to that, but during our consultation under New Deal, did we get some views from tenants about the whole issue about grounds for eviction and whether they should be reviewed, modified, changed or otherwise, but we've decided to keep them the same, I think.
Yes, I think we are still keen to progress a review of the grounds for eviction, but it's not something that was possible to progress in time for this legislation because of the focus on other significant changes at this time. Charlotte, I don't know if you want to come in with any more on that.
I think the sort of New Deal for Tenants consultation was almost the start of the process of us gathering information about the use of the eviction grounds and people's views. So we've already have some information around sort of people's views on how it's operating and concerns about how some of the grounds are operating. I think really the main focus is this review that we are still committed to, that will take an opportunity to have a look and also to look at some of the changes that have come through since over the last few years. For example, there was a move following the Recovery and Reform Act, Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Act, to make all grounds discretionary. So the review and allowing some of that to bed in will provide an opportunity to review that aspect as well.
Okay, thank you. On the question of damages for unlawful eviction, there was a temporary measure in place that's now being formalised, I think, in the bill. What evidence do we have to support formalising that now?
Do you want to take this one, Charlotte?
You're right, we changed temporarily through the cost of living to a very similar, we have tweaked it slightly, process that we've put into the bill. What we have seen was an increase in applications to the tribunal, which it had been a very underused. We know from research, for example, that Citizens Advice Service have put out that we think there are a higher level of illegal evictions than necessarily it comes through any prosecutions or through people seeking lawful eviction damages. During the cost of living, there was an increase in applications. We are monitoring the decisions that are coming out of the tribunal, so far we haven't managed to tell too much from that, but we will continue to do so, as they will. The cases that are in the system will still remain under the Cost of Living Act until they're concluded.
I mean, Charlotte, is it hundreds or thousands of cases per year, do you think, roughly?
We don't have official data in terms of illegal evictions. In terms of the number of cases that come through, it's really been handfuls over the last few years. So there does seem to be a big disconnect between the numbers, I think, that Citizens Advice were thinking were higher than we're getting through any official stats.
Okay, my last query is just about joint tenancy. It's not really about evictions, but joint tenancies and the requirement to give 2 months' notice to the other tenant. Is that, how did we arrive at this figure of 2 months? Is it fair to potential other tenants that may wish to come in and join that tenancy?
The 2 months' notice, what we did was look to align it with actually the 3 months' notice period that landlords are required to give for the majority of tenancies where they come to an end. So so the 2 months then plus the standard 28-day notice period that then goes to the landlord gives them that 3 month period. So it does align with that. We're also trying to balance the time and giving those remaining tenants, because they haven't come to an agreement. So this, we don't see this process being used often. This is for where no mutual agreement is possible. It's about giving them reasonable time to find alternative accommodation if that is needed, or to look for another tenant for that to be assigned to agree with the landlord. But we're also balancing that with if, for example, someone is in an abusive relationship and it's been used as a means of control, we want to make sure that timescale isn't overly long. So we've tried to balance those two elements of giving remaining tenants sufficient time to get housing advice, work out with their landlord what they're going to do, but also to protect those people who might be in a really difficult position.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much for those answers. Thank you.
I think it may be worth highlighting, if I may, that it is designed as an alternative route. It's not designed to be the main way by which these things might be resolved. We recognise that in many cases, between tenants and landlords, it will be perfectly possible to resolve these without recourse to this legal route. But it's providing that certainty that there is one there if it's required in certain circumstances.
Okay. Thanks very much again. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I just wanted to pick up something on the evictions piece around the around purpose-built student accommodation. So that's not covered. Is there scope for covering that in this bill? Did you consider that? It was covered during the pandemic.
Yes, yeah, it was considered, but the point of that there has been an ongoing review of purpose-built student accommodation, and we are still at a point of considering those recommendations. That's still working its way through the process. So the timing was one consideration for us in considering whether to reflect any changes within this bill. I think the other thinking for us was our measures here are primarily based around private residential tenancies, which of course is a very different arrangement to that in place for those living in purpose-built student accommodation. So while there are obviously links, we didn't feel that it was appropriate timing-wise and in terms of the core purpose of our bill to bring PBSA into consideration here.
Do you think... So I hear like it's timing and also kind of the purpose of this bill. But as your review develops in the coming months and this bill still goes through the process, do you think that you might come to a different view based on that review?
Yeah, and I think we're absolutely in a place of listening to all stakeholders across the piece in terms of what's required to meet the purpose of our bill here. We do recognise that students and student tenants need to be considered as part of this, particularly those living in private residential tenancies, recognising that is also a part of the picture. Mm. However, we will need to balance that with practicalities of ensuring we continue to meet bill timetables. So there will be a balancing act, but we're very much looking to take views and evidence from stakeholders, from Parliament, about any changes that might be considered, but this isn't something that has had the full consideration that the other elements of the bill have had from an official perspective, from our policy work and our legal work. But as I say, we're really keen to understand what it is that stakeholders might be looking for from future legislation and how we can ensure that there is a good level of housing rights and protection for students in PBSA.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. We're going to move on to a theme around implementation, and I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camira. The Nationwide Foundation's Better Renting research found that some tenants were less likely to exercise their rights due to a power imbalance between tenants and landlords. You know, there's a perception for landlords that if they try to enforce their rights, they'll simply be evicted. So I wonder whether you're able to say how we're going to be able to, giving tenants more rights, actually give them more power individually to enforce them.
I've spoken a lot today about our work with local authorities on the implementation of this, but our work with the First Tier Tribunal and Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services is going to be really important in all of this as well. So the first thing I would reflect, making sure that the rights, the enhanced rights that we're bringing forwards here are practically deliverable, and ensuring that we have a really clear sense of how these things will be implemented. Turning to the provisions in the bill, I think that the measures described which will allow for rent adjudication to decrease rent as well as increase it, I think that's a really important practical shift in terms of tenants' rights within the system. Significant increases in damages for unlawful evictions, that's again very much intended to address that that imbalance that we've heard about from tenants, and to make sure that there's a really significant deterrent for landlords in terms of anyone who might choose to progress an illegal eviction, making it so costly and therefore risky, and trying to create that incentive to ensure people do follow the due process and that tenants are able to access their rights. And then I think the other thing that we have mentioned already today is that really ensuring strong communication to tenants of what their rights are, and making sure that there's a really high level of understanding, working with partners such as Citizens Advice, Shelter and other partners. We've done some work with Young Scot around the reaching young people in particular, making sure that those rights are well understood. We need to continue that process as well. So it's not the current protections and the framework that we have in Scotland has great strength to it. It's still relatively recent and new, and there is a real job in terms of communicating that clearly so that people know when they need it, what their rights are, and how they can access those things. But equally making sure that the practical framework is in place with our partners so that access to that justice and access to rights is a part of the process as well. So I think I would see it as a very evolving picture still as we ensure high awareness of those 2016 Act rights, as well as these additional rights that we're seeking to build in if this bill is passed in Parliament. I don't know if colleagues would have anything to add.
In terms of the rent control measures that have been brought forward in the bill, we have considered what tenants might need to help them to exercise their rights. So there are provisions included in the bill that will place obligations on landlords in terms of the information they include in any advertisement for a rented property. And we will make some changes that relate to the information that a landlord is required to provide to tenants at the start of a new tenancy. So that tenants are aware that they're in a rent control area, what the previous rent for the property was, so that they can be assured that any new tenancy has a rent that's in accordance with the requirements. And we've also looked to make sure there's a provision for tenants to have any rent increase notice in a rent control area verified. So we will bring forward tools and information and guidance that will support tenants and landlords to understand the operation of the rent control area. But where a tenant has a concern, then we will provide a route of the bill provides for a route of verification where they can ask Rent Service Scotland to verify that the rent increases within the requirements for that particular area. So we have given some considerations as to how we can best help tenants and what information we can make sure they have to help them to exercise their rent and their rights in the new rent control areas.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks very much. And we spoke at the beginning about balance, and so I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol with a question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Housing developers have said that rent controls are hindering the supply of new homes. Has any assessment been made of the impacts of the bill on the supply of private homes? And what evidence do you currently have about how the private rented sector has been changing in light of the recent rent increase caps?
Thank you. A really, really important question. And the first thing I would want to say is Scottish ministers are really clear that we're looking to build a future system here in which investment in rented homes is both viable and beneficial to tenants. So we absolutely recognise that that needs to be a part of our planning and our consideration of the bill. We have got good relationships with a range of stakeholders across private investment and in housing. And from those conversations, we're getting a really good sense of where their concerns are. And we are looking to work with them to understand how those concerns can be addressed in terms of how the bill is framed and how it's implemented. But not forgetting that the core purpose of protecting tenants and stabilising rents in terms of rent control is something that we need to look to achieve as well. And ministers have been really clear throughout the development of the bill that in investment in private housing is not incompatible with rent control, and we know from other countries that there are things that can support that and things that could work against it. So in designing a system that works effectively for Scotland, we're looking to get all stakeholder views and to balance those and consider them as the bill progresses. In terms of evidence of how the recent legislative measures have impacted, we've had helpful information from investor stakeholders about their own assessments of what might have happened. It is difficult to know what would have happened if things had been different. Always, it's always hypothetical, but it's something that we are paying really close attention to, and recognising that continued investment in supply of homes is a really important consideration. Stakeholder groups that we have and have supported us thus far will continue to be really important as we progress with conversations and considerations in the passage of the bill. I think you may have made another point that I'm not sure if I've addressed all the points.
Yeah, but assessment being the impact on the bill and evidence, I think you've covered that, yeah.
Yeah.
Just on a supplementary, obviously rents are rising and ONS have shown that they've increased by 16.5% since the introduction of the rent cap, and that's faster than anywhere else in the United Kingdom. And how would you ensure that bill does not have the similar effect? I know you've said that obviously you've been speaking to stakeholders, yeah, but what is coming out so far? And is there any sort of benchmarking or sort of any example anywhere else that you can look at that this has happened and why it's happened?
Yeah.
I mean, people really can't afford it. We've heard, obviously, evidence in this committee, not just the developers coming in, but others. It's just unaffordable, and, you know, for people to afford it, to rent. And a lot of the housing developers felt that they were being squeezed out of the market. They felt that that's why these restrictions are in. And so both sides, kind of the people renting, it's too high for them. The people that obviously need to rent out and have properties there, the supply, there's a problem there. I mean, these are two different problems, but obviously they do link together. So what's so far coming out, the stakeholders and the talks you're having, how to resolve this situation?
Yeah, we are recognising that the core purpose of the bill, as introduced, was to, of the rent control provision, sorry, was to stabilise rents balanced with the property rights of landlords. We also recognise from our conversations with stakeholders that avoiding any reduction in investment in housing supply is a really important part of this picture as well. So that is the key central message that I think is coming through from those stakeholder conversations. We know that investors are looking for as much certainty as possible, and that is something we will continue to look at, but balanced with the need for local sensitivity and responsiveness. We also recognise that it is important that we build the bill in a way that has flexibility built in, so that there are measures allowing for specifics to be set out in regulation, so that those can be changed over time to respond to what's happening and to what we're seeing, to make sure that we're able to respond to any unintended consequences arising, but equally looking now at what measures could support a mitigation of the risks that stakeholders are flagging to us, a risk of lower stakeholder confidence, lower investor confidence, a risk of private landlords perhaps not being sure of the timescales of what's involved, or not being sure of how that will impact on them. And we are working on how we can strengthen the safeguards that are already in there, but again, without undermining that core purpose of the bill, which is about protecting tenants. I think we may have discussed this before you joined the session. We were reflecting on the Cost of Living Act and the implications of that being clear. So when we look at the way that rents have increased in the 16% figure that you mentioned, that is based on advertised rents. It's not reflecting in any way in-tenancy rent experiences. And we know from the provisions of the Cost of Living Act that anyone who was covered by that act will not have seen their rents increasing. They will have been at 0% for a period. They will have been at 3% for the most part, with 6% in some cases. So there will have been a big difference between tenants' rents within a tenancy versus between tenancies. And the measures that we are bringing forward today, if a rent control area is designated, there would be controls possible on both within tenancies and between tenancies. So that would not be the same situation as we had with the blanket approach across the whole of Scotland and not having that those different measures. And I think that point about this being a locally designed, so it's a national system, but with that local flexibility and implementation, means that there is greater sensitivity to different areas and what's being experienced in that area. And we think that's a really important part of mitigating some of those unintended consequences. There will also be a continued duty on Scottish ministers to ensure that for the period a rent control area is designated, that it remains proportionate and necessary. So there will be a monitoring that will need to be going on as part of that as well.
You talk about proportionate and necessary. Obviously, it's very important. I've spoke about, obviously, new home supply being built, and I've talked about how people can't afford to rent in these properties. But we mustn't, obviously, forget those landlords that you've just mentioned, yes, that some of them have got high mortgages, and they have to have the right amount of money to pay that. And that's why sometimes it may be, and if you can give me any statistics on this data, that they are squeezed outside the market, saying that, no, you know, we're not going to put homes because we don't get that return to even just pay for a simple mortgage or a simple, you know, loan on that property. So what's your view on that?
We are really aware of those considerations, and it's been central to our conversations with organisations like the Scottish Association of Landlords. And we know that there's been various surveys of members conducted, and I think Scottish Land and Estates as well have done similar processes. And we know that there is a real sense of uncertainty and apprehensiveness about what this will mean for individual landlords. Obviously, recent years have seen a very high sustained pressure on people's mortgages, on interest rates and so on, and recognising that that does also have an impact on landlords is definitely part of our consideration. I think that one of the things that we're keeping a really close eye on is the landlord registration system and how many properties are being brought forward for rent. And the latest data I've got here shows that the number of registered properties for rent in Scotland between August 2022 and March 2024, there's actually been an increase in the number of properties by 2.1%. Now, that's not perfect data, but it is an indication that we look at regularly to just check in on whether we're seeing any change playing out in practice in terms of the availability of properties. We're not seeing that as yet, but it is something that we're really mindful of the need to recognise that is a really important part of the system. We want to ensure that we've got a thriving private rented sector where it's a viable proposition for investment, but that is always focused on affordable, high-quality homes that meet people's needs in that sector. So getting that balance right absolutely means hearing from landlords, hearing their concerns, looking at what we can do to mitigate some of the risks that they're flagging to us, and ensure that we are bringing forwards a package of measures that best meets that overall aim of providing great homes in the PRS. I don't know if colleagues would want to add anything.
To move on now, and yeah, we're kind of getting a bit pressed for time, but thanks so much for that kind of clarification and the work you've been doing with landlords, but also the monitoring of the landlord registration scheme and that data of the 2.1% increase. So we actually have come to the end of our session. I think it's been really helpful to have you here and be able to ask questions and get some of that detail on your thinking behind the legislation and its intention. And I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of our witnesses. I now welcome Christopher Donaldson, who forms our second panel, and Chris is the head of Rent Service Scotland. And I'll begin with an opening question. Be interested to have an explanation from you of how the adjudication process in the 2016 Act works in practice, what timescales are involved, and what data do you use to make an assessment of open market rents?
Good morning.
Good morning.
The rent adjudication process came into force in December 2017 and it was then suspended in September 2022 when the Cost of Living Act came in. And during that time, there was quite a low uptake by tenants on the process. So what happens is a landlord would issue a rent increase notice, giving the tenant 3 months' intended notice of that increase. They have 21 days to apply to a rent officer, and they can then submit that application, and we have approximately 40 days to process that. So we will look at the property, we will probably go out and inspect it and value it. Sometimes the landlord or the tenant will send in photographic evidence as well to support if there's any issues. And we will then use comparable evidence and come to a valuation on that property. We'll then make an order which will set the rent at an amount of that increase. And the tenant and landlord have a couple of weeks to then appeal that decision. And if they're unhappy with it, a senior rent officer will review it, make a final order, and if they're still unhappy, then they can go to the first tier tribunal to appeal a further stage. We publish those decisions on our webpage. It's a rent adjudication register, and that also gives them the sort of opportunity to see the comparable evidence that we've used. It's obviously redacted. It will give them the kind of geographic postcode, the number of bedrooms, the rental amount, etc. But it lets them see how it's been used. So since kind of 2017, in the first year we had low numbers. It was like two applications, 19, 20. Then in kind of 21, it increased to 44. And in 2022, until September, we had 96. So at the times, it wasn't very well publicised. It was a low uptake. And there was also maybe some tenants' apprehension to apply because they felt there was other issues that could be used against them. So that then changed from the 1st of April when the Cost of Living Act expired. There was a new modifications made to rent adjudication, and that started in the last 2 months.
Okay, thanks very much for that overview there. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's got another question.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wanted to ask if there have been any problems accessing sufficient data to make comparisons about open market rent levels, and whether that's any more of a problem in city, towns, rural areas. If you get any information on that.
We already have sort of a couple of statutory functions to compile data, and that's primarily for setting local housing allowance rates, setting universal credit housing element rates as well, as using it for comparable evidence for various other decisions we have to make for benefit purposes. So we collect it by broad rental market area. So there's 18 of those in the country. There's 32 of its local authority zones in Scotland that make up these broad rental market areas. We have certain challenges in some areas where, yes, maybe the rural, some of the islands, some of the more desirable where there's a lot of holiday lets, there could be a scarcity of properties. But we collect a random sample that averages between about maybe 10, 12, 15% that we collect across various bedroom sizes, property types across each area. If we get an application in for, it could be any property in the sector, so if it's maybe, say, you know, a flat in a castle, something quite unique, then we will go and try and find comparable evidence at that time. But we do have quite a large pool of data to pull on over the years that we've been collecting it.
Thank you.
It's quite insightful. Of course, my ears pricked up around the rural and the island issues. Pam, you have a question.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Christopher. Morning. The Housing Bill proposes to remove the ability of the rent officer to set a rent higher than the rent proposed by the landlord. In practice, how often does the rent officer set a rent higher than what the landlord proposed? And what impact do you think that this might have on tenants' willingness to refer a rent increase notice for adjudication?
Since 2017, we have used it a couple of times to set it higher. I can't obviously comment what the FTT, the First Tier Tribunal, have used, but for us it's been a couple. We could either set the rent at the same as that requested, or higher or lower. So if that proposal comes in, it may take away some of that tenant fear and apprehension of, well, if I'm applying for this, you could set it even higher than that requested. Don't have any data on that I can say. But the number of maybe inquiries that we get through our helplines is relatively high, but we don't always see that resulting in an application at that stage. So difficult to know how it will impact. But we will be using, obviously, comparable data to set an open market rent at that point.
Okay. No. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Just picking up on that, because it came up in the earlier session as well, around the fact that you get high-level inquiries, but then not that doesn't translate to the next step. And I just wonder if you have any ability to understand what's going on there. Is there something that we need to be thinking about in terms of supporting people through that process more?
The application process is free, so there is no charge to attempt to apply. We get roughly each month, maybe varying between a couple of 100 to 400 inquiries via telephone or email. We don't see that number, so if we look back to 2022, we had 96 rent adjudications. However, since April, that's obviously changed, and we've had between 300 and 400 per month. So whether the sort of, what would you say, the willingness to apply at that point, and obviously they can go for advice to citizens' advice, different agencies for help. There was also quite a good marketing campaign at the start of this year, which highlighted tenants' rights to apply. So maybe a mixture of just more awareness as well the right.
Great, thanks. Gordon, do you want to come in with a supplement?
Yep. Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. Just a quick clarification on what you said earlier on about when you're considering a rent increase, you maybe go out and inspect a property. Are you in a situation where you carry out, you look at the condition of the property, and it might be black mould, it might be dodgy electrics, it might be the bathroom or kitchen that are needing upgraded? Can you make any recommendations about that in carrying out the rent assessment? And does the tenant have any rights to appeal the rent level on the grounds of the condition of the property?
Yeah, we will value that property based on a hypothetical tenant, a hypothetical landlord, and we'll consider if there's any improvements the landlord has made or the tenant has made to that valuation. If there are issues, they already have a lot of various recourses that they can apply to local authority, the First Tier Tribunal, about the condition of the property. We will signpost them as well to these organisations if there is an issue, likes of mould or, you know, faulty central heating, things like that. Yes, it will have an impact on the valuation of the property. Okay. There is some that, you know, they make not of running water, for instance, even in this day and age. So, yes, it will have an impact.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks for that. Willie, you've got a question.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Hi, Chris. It's just about your caseload, and you've been talking about numbers there, and I think you said in 2019 there was about 20 applications, then 44, then 96, and you're taking 400 calls per, I don't know, is that every day?
Per month.
Per month.
Per month.
Thank goodness. So are you anticipating that your caseload will go up as a result of the bill? And could you answer again, why if you're getting so many inquiries, like up to 400, are you not getting nowhere near that in terms of applications for adjudication? Is it just being resolved over the phone?
Yes, some of the inquiries will be resolved, but once, I suppose, the tenant then goes away and thinks about it and all their considerations, we don't really see that materialising in an application. Since the modifications come in the 1st of April, we've had about 696 up until Sunday. So we're roughly, I think we saw about 400 in the first month and 300 in May. So there's been a huge increase in the number of applications. Obviously, there's a lot going on in the sector, but I think there's also been that successful marketing campaign just to highlight the rights to apply.
Mm-hmm. And do you think the bill will make that go even higher? And can you cope with that level of increased caseload?
Potentially, with the ability to set a rent higher, that could make it more attractive to a tenant to apply. So potentially, yes, that could take away their fear. And they would then just apply. There's no cost to them, so there is nothing for them to lose as such by applying. We can't set it higher than what the landlord has requested. So, yes, potentially that could increase to larger numbers. Resources-wise, obviously there would be a financial memorandum to go along with the bill, and we've put estimates in there as what we think, based on what analysts and economists' views, where it may lead to by volumes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for that.
Thanks. Miles, you've got...
Thank you. Rita, thanks for joining us. I had a question with regards to the understanding between tenants and landlords, and just wondered to what extent do you think both tenants and landlords understand the adjudication process you've outlined and their rights and entitlements with regards to that as well?
We have guidance pages, so we have an online application form to try and make it easier and more accessible. They can still get paper copies as well. And the guidance pages are quite self-explanatory to try and put it into plain English as to how you can apply. There's also been a lot of press interest over the months and previous years about rents and about the rising costs. The Cost of Living Act come in for to help sitting tenants with it, and there was caps imposed at that point. So I think people are a lot more aware now, and especially if they see it's a free application and there's no risk to them as such, then I think it's more accessible to apply.
And looking at where, you know, when you look at the rented market in Scotland, a lot are individual additional properties people have. They're not big landlords. There's data which is available now showing a lot of them are moving out of being landlords because I could only expect some of these changes. With the housing bill coming, bringing another set of regulations and duties they will have to follow, do you have any data or information from people contacting you which suggests these landlords who may have inherited a property which they rent out are likely to just sell up and leave the market? In Edinburgh, it's a buoyant housing market, so the property can be sold quite easily. There is evidence of that taking place, but the national data set doesn't seem to be available to look at that. Just wondered what your views were around that and the information you're gathering from people contacting you.
We don't collect any data on that. We look at the landlord registration numbers, but that's over a 3-year time series where the licence is valid. So we don't actually see that. We do have odd phone calls where, you know, one or two will say, my mortgage costs are increasing, I can't afford to keep my property, I can't afford to keep a tenant in it, and I'm going to sell. But we don't collect any stats on that, and we don't know how much of that would actually move into fruition. Whilst we're collecting data, we will see adverts, you know, on maybe estate agents or auction sites, and it will say sold with a sitting tenant. So there's things like that that we do pick up on, but we don't have any statistical numbers.
Okay, on that. That's great. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. I just wanted to, you mentioned the in right at the beginning of our conversation, you mentioned a 21-day period. And I just wanted to know if that's 3 weeks or 21 working days.
It's 3 weeks. Yeah.
And do you think that's enough time for somebody to who's not familiar with the process, maybe knows their rights or maybe doesn't, mm-hmm. but to kind of become alert to the situation and get motivated to do something about it?
Yeah, it was set in legislation in 2016, and it was a 3-week period that was put in. Obviously, there's only 3 months that rent increase will take effect from if it's unchallenged. So it's there to give them initial time to apply. The application form is about 7 or 8 pages, so it's not great detail, and it's quite easy to fill in online or in a paper form and send in to us. It's also to stop any delay to the rent increase taking effect as well. So that's basically taking up the first 3 or 21 days of a 90-day period. The majority that we see all come in within timescales. I have no stats on, you know, whether there's like so many would hit and decide not to apply before the 21 days. But if the landlord emails a rent increase notice or posts it to them, it gives them 3 weeks to actually apply to us.
Okay, great. All right, well, that comes to the end of our questions. So thanks so much for joining us this morning. It's been, I think, helpful to understand a bit more about what you're doing at Rent Service Scotland. And as that was the final public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of our meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.